ألف لام را كتاب أنزلناه إليك لتخرج الناس من الظلمات إلى النور إلى النور بإذن ربهم إلى صراط العزيز الحميد.
إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله والسلام عليه. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. إخواني, the brothers have chosen a topic for me, which is Ruqya. I understand that last week the Qari, he came in and he spoke about magic. Now you'll have to bear with me because there's always a little bit of overlap between jinn, ruqya, magic. There's always going to be an overlap, so forgive me if I mention anything that the Qari mentioned previously. Today, inshallah, I was thinking, how can we derive maximum benefit from this session? Sometimes what I do is I just go and I'll mention some stories that have taken place, which when I've been doing ruqya, maybe the jinn has spoken and we've had a, you know, we can derive some benefits from that. But today, I want to try and give you, brothers and sisters, like a toolkit. I want to try and give you a toolkit which you can then go away and you can educate people in your community. Because you guys are a little bit far out from Birmingham here, so that I don't know of any Raqis in this area who are doing Ruqya according to Quran and Sunnah. Allahu alam if there is, but me personally, I'm not aware of any. So inshallah, I just wanted to give you, brothers, like a framework on which to build your knowledge of Ruqya. Whenever we are looking at anything, we have to define our term. So what does this term ruqya mean? Has it been mentioned in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? The answer is yes, it has been mentioned in the sunnah of the Messenger alayhi salam. In Sahih Muslim, on the authority of Auf ibn Malik, he says that we used to recite ruqya during the times of Jahiliyyah. So during the times of Jahiliyyah, they used to recite ruqya. And we said, O Messenger of Allah, what do you think about this? So they went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they told him about the different du'as and the different things that they would recite during ruqya. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, recite your ruqyas to me. And then he said, there is nothing wrong with a ruqya that does not involve shirk. So the fact is, this word ruqya, it is actually found in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we have narrated from Jabir radiallahu an that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he forbade ruqya. So these people, they came and they wanted to make ruqya, but at this stage the people were new to Islam. So the Prophet alaihi salam, he forbade all forms of ruqya to do what? To close the doors to shirk. The same way, at the beginning, at the early stages of Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he forbade the Muslims from visiting the graveyards. Why? Because he didn't want them, they were new to Islam, he didn't want them to go to the graves and start asking of the graves, falling into shirk. So he closed the door completely. So Jabir, and this is in Sahih Muslim, he says the Messenger of Allah, he forbade ruqya. And then the family of Amr ibn Hazm, they came and they said, O Messenger of Allah, we had ruqya that we used to recite for scorpion stings, but now you have forbidden ruqya. And so they recited the ruqya that they had to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, I do not see anything wrong with it. Whoever among you can benefit his brother, then let him do so. So again, they recited their ruqya. In other words, ruqya is the recitation of Quran. It is the recitation of azkar from the Prophet, from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, seeking a cure for all illnesses. Seeking a cure for all illnesses, but in particular, ruqya is seeking a cure for jinn possession. Ruqya is seeking a cure for magic. And ruqya is seeking a cure for ayn, for evil eye. So this is a broad definition. recitation of Quran and du'as which are found in the authentic sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salam, seeking a cure for magic, jinn possession and evil eye, but it can also be used by an individual over himself to seek cure for all illnesses. Why? Because Allah says, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. We have sent down this Qur'an, that which is a healing and a mercy for the believers. So this Qur'an is a healing for all illnesses. Whether it be the common cold, whether it be a physical illness, whether it be a mental illness, whether it be a disease of the heart such as backbiting, such as hatred and jealousy, the Qur'an is a cure and a healing from beginning to end. From beginning to end, the Qur'an is a healing and a cure. But ikhwani, we must remember that as Muslims, we only place our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, when we perform ruqya, what is our intention? Our intention is that we are tying the camel, we are following the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, and we hope and we make dua and we ask Allah to place shifa and to send down the shifa in the recitation. So it's not for me or for you to say, I'm the one who's going to cure you by the Quran. No, we just recite, we tie our camel and we ask Allah to put shifa in our recitation. I want to mention now, how is ruqya used for jinn possession? How is ruqya used for magic? How is ruqya used for evil eye? So let's, first and foremost, let's look at how ruqya is used for jinn possession. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions in the Qur'an that the one who indulges in riba, he indulges in interest, it's like he's been touched by a shaitan. It's like he's been touched by the mass of a shaitan. He's been touched by shaitan. And in the hadith, in the authentic hadith, we have the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us that shaitan flows through the son of Adam like his blood. So this is just some proof and some evidences that the jinn possession is real. And jinn possession exists. Because subhanAllah, we have people who call themselves Muslims, they don't even accept jinn possession. What are some of the signs of jinn possession? Some of the signs of jinn possession is, number one, very, very poor hygiene. Very, very poor hygiene. We know that the jinn, they like to stay in places of filth, places of dirt. This is why when we enter into the bathroom, we make the dua, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubathi wal-khaba'ith. Oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from the male and female unclean, impure spirits. So they like to stay in places of filth. So when a person is possessed, it's not uncommon to find that they don't take a shower for an entire month, or they don't take a shower for 2 or 3 or even 4 months. Subhanallah. Why? Because the jinn likes that position and that place of filth, that place of impurity. And so this is why when they are inside of a person, they will make washing hated to that person. They will instill a hatred in showering and purity and cleanliness. And this is why we as Muslims, we need to make sure that our bodies are places of purity. Allah loves the tawabina, and He loves the mutatahireen. Allah loves those who turn to Him in repentance, and He loves those who are pure. So we have to make ourselves pure, we make our bodies pure. A second sign of jinn possession is using very, very foul and evil language and telling lies. This is from the footsteps of shaitan. And they love it when we swear and when we tell lies and we use lewd speech. This is bringing you closer to shaitan. It's not bringing you closer to Allah. So previously this person, he may have had upright character. He may have been somebody who did not use expletives and foul language. But subhanAllah, now all of a sudden, it's like somebody's flicked a switch. Now he's swearing a lot. Now he's telling a lot of lies. The third thing is a hatred towards Quran, a hatred towards Salah, a hatred towards the Adhan in particular. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he told us in an authentic hadith, when the Adhan is made, the shaitan, he flees, he runs away. And then he comes back, and then when the Iqama is made, he runs away. And then he comes back, And then whilst you are praying, he comes and he whispers to you. So the fact here, the point of benefit from this hadith, when the adhan is made, the shaitan, he flees. So they have a hatred towards all things to do with the adhan, to do with tawheed, to do with sunnah. They hate everything that is to do with that. So you might find that a person, he was previously very upright in his religious conduct, but subhanallah, now he wants nothing to do with Islam. Now he wants nothing to do with Islam. But a point to benefit from here, just because a person goes off the deen doesn't necessarily mean he's possessed. Just because you might see one or two of these symptoms doesn't mean that the person is possessed. Another sign of jinn possession is that the person, he is extremely strong. Extremely strong. So you might have a young lady and she's only a small in her build, but it takes three or four of her family members to hold her down because she has extreme strength. This is from the jinn possession. Other things that you might have, the person, they like to go out at night. In the middle of the night, you find them walking around graveyards, you find them walking around trees and parks and water. They just like seclusion. They like to be secluded, but it's not a natural seclusion. Some of us, we like to take a moment out, reflect, but this is not a natural seclusion. This person, they don't want to see anybody. They don't want to go out. They may develop the phobia, and it's like a medical condition. I think it's called agoraphobia, which keeps a person away from people, and they don't like to go out, and they don't like to mix. Many times, this is an indication of jinn possession. What type of ruqya should we recite on this person now? So the first thing to do is to sit this person down and is to explain to them. Explain to them that, look, I am going to recite Quran upon you now. Put your trust in Allah, don't rely upon me. Rather put your trust in Allah. Give them da'wah, because don't forget, if there is a jinn, you're not only giving the person da'wah, but the jinn is witnessing what you're saying as well. So give them da'wah. So explain to them, this Qur'an is a shifa. This Qur'an is a mercy and a healing. But also Allah says, وَلَا يَزِيدُ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا خَسَارًا. It does not increase the ظَالِمِينَ, the wrongdoers, the evildoers, except in wrongdoing and suffering. So give them da'wah. Then start. Start with the isti'adha. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Start with Surah Fatiha. Start with Surah Fatiha. Recite Surah Fatiha three times. Then start with the opening of Surah Al-Baqarah. Start with the opening of Surah Al-Baqarah. And recite as much of Surah Al-Baqarah as you possibly can. If you're able to, if you have the time, then just recite all of Surah Al-Baqarah over this person. Because the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he told us that the shaitan will not enter into a home in which Surah Al-Baqarah is recited. So if you recite all of Surah Al-Baqarah, then it will protect your house, and at the same time it will cause immense pain and suffering for the jinn. Recite Ayatul Kursi. Recite the last two ayat of Surah Al-Baqarah. Then you can recite ayat in the Quran where Allah says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created mankind and jinn except to worship me alone. Then recite these other ayat. Now this is where you yourself, you need to judge now. Is this jinn a Muslim jinn? So if the person is possessed, within a minute or 2 minutes or 10 minutes of your recitation, you'll begin to get a reaction. This person, they will begin to shake, they may begin to cry, they may begin to scream, they may try and attack you, which is why it's important to have people to hold them down, especially if it's a female and she's not, you know, you're not her mahram, you need her mahram present so that he can hold her down. She may try and attack you, may try and run out of the room, she may try and scream and shout to try and drown out the sound of the Qur'an so that she can't hear it. In this instance, tell her, look, be quiet, listen to Qur'an. So you continue with the recitation until you find you will just begin to have a feeling that this jinn now can't really take it. At this stage, ask the jinn, why are you here? What has caused you to enter into this person? Now some of the scholars, they mention that you shouldn't talk to the jinn. Others say there's nothing wrong with it. But we have to be very careful. The jinn, they will talk to you all night long. Why? Because when you are talking, you're not reciting Qur'an. So it's like you think that you're gaining some benefit, But subhanAllah, actually they're playing you for a fool. Because you, while you are talking, you are not reciting Qur'an, they are regaining their strength. They are regaining their strength. Imagine it's like a boxing match. You hit the man and you knock him down. Now either you can continue to hit him until his lights are out, or you can just talk to him. Talk to him. And he'll happily talk to you. Because while you're talking, what is he doing? He's regaining his strength. So this is why we don't talk to the jinn too much. We say to them, Bismillah, leave. Why have you entered? And they will maybe give you a load of excuses. And they'll say, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do this. Say, no, look, I don't want to hear it. Bismillah, you leave. And if you don't leave, I'm going to continue with Qur'an. And then just continue reciting. And eventually, inshallah, they will leave. They will leave. So I'll mention something that happened with myself once. There was a sister, and she used to walk through the park a lot. She used to walk through the park after Maghrib to get home. The jinn took a liking to her and he possessed her. And what the jinn wanted to do was to get her away from her family, and so he could have her all to himself. And so he began to break the ties of kinship. He began to, you know, make her swear and shout and be very violent towards her family. They were extremely stressed. So we went down and I just started reciting. Within, again, like 5 minutes, the jinn started crying and bawling and etc, etc. We just said to the jinn, look, you need to leave. Fear Allah, we're going to kill you. Alhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah, when it's just jinn possession, when it's just jinn possession and nothing else, this is the easiest thing to get rid of. Because the Quran, it burns them so much that they don't want to stay. So you'll recite for like 20 minutes, half an hour, 1 hour, and after that, they will leave. Because they're burning so much, they think, you know what, this person isn't worth it, I don't want anything to do with them. If it's a Muslim jinn, then you can give them da'wah, you can remind them of Allah, you can remind them of Yawm al-Qiyamah, remind them of the punishment in the grave, remind them about hellfire, remind them about Jannah. Remind them about Jannah and hellfire, give them da'wah. Why? Because they are Muslim. So when you remind them about the Akhirah, when you invite them about the Hisab, it's going to hit home. It's going to have an effect. And they will leave, inshaAllah. When is Ruqya required for magic? Now in actual fact, Ikhwani, like each of these topics, you can do a full like one day seminar on each of these topics. But let's just be let's summarize. When is Ruqya required for magic? The first thing, there are different types of magic. Magic to separate a husband from his wife. Magic to destroy a person. Magic to make a person weak. Magic to destroy the livelihood of a person. Magic to make somebody fall in love with somebody else. Magic to destroy a family. There are many, many different types of magic. Magic to make a person lose his mind. There are different types of magic. In all of these though, again, give you a framework. You will always ask the person about their dreams. Ask the person about their dreams. Don't try and interpret their dreams, but ask the person about their dreams. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His immense mercy, He will never ever let a person suffer except that He gives them some signs. Oh my slave, you are suffering. This is from the mercy of Allah. In their dreams, they will see snakes. In their dreams, they will see dogs. In their dreams, they might see blood. They may see dead bodies. They may see spiders. Or they may see other animals, other predators. And these animals are attacking them, or they're circling them, or they are constricting them if it's a snake. All these type of things. Now, we shouldn't get worried thinking, I had a dream 6 months ago of a snake. It's not like that. When a person is suffering, they will see the dreams continuously, on a continuous basis, maybe every night, every few nights, a few nights in a week, they will see these dreams. And their dreams will be extremely vivid and clear, such that they can tell you exactly this is what happened, this is what happened. Or they may see in their dreams themselves eating something, because one of the ways of magic is that they will sprinkle magic onto your food. Magic is like, it can be made into a powder form. They will sprinkle it onto your food and the person will ingest it. And now the person will start to become possessed, and they will have the effects of magic. Magic can also be from your hair, it can also be from your clothing, from a bangle, from an earring. Somebody takes something like this and they will do magic on it. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he used to comb his beard and a Jewish man got hold of his comb, and on his comb, as anybody who knows who combs their beard, you sometimes have hair that comes out on your comb. So the Jewish man, he did magic on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam via the comb, and then he did magic on it, he tied knots on it, and then he threw it into the well. And subhanallah, this was a very testing time for the Messenger alayhi salatu salam. He would wake up at Fajr time and he would go and do the ghusl. And his wife Aisha radiallahu anha would ask him, "Why are you doing the ghusl?" And then he would begin to forget and he would say, "We had relations last night." She would say, "No, we never had relations last night." So he was beginning to forget. But subhanallah, an important point. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when it came down to revelation, he never ever forgot revelation. It was only aspects of his dunya life, of his life as a normal man, he would forget some aspects of this. He never ever forgot the Qur'an, he never became confused with the Qur'an, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the Qur'an. Allah says in the Qur'an, "We have sent it down and we will protect it." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected this. What to recite on somebody who has magic? I'll just mention some more symptoms. They may, if they have bad stomach, if they've ingested the magic, they will always, always have bad stomach. Always, always have a bad stomach. Regardless of what they eat, they will always have a bad stomach. So we've mentioned their dreams. We've mentioned their health implications. Other things that they may have a type of illness, the doctors, they simply can't diagnose it. The doctors, they simply can't diagnose it. I had a sister who came to me and she had a heart problem. And her heart efficiency went down to 5%. And the doctor said, "You have a few days or a week to live. Just a few days or a week to live." And like that was 6 months ago, she went back to the doctors and mashallah, she's fine, or she's improving. And the doctors, they were absolutely dumbfounded. They said, "It's impossible that you are living today after what you had." So subhanallah, another point of benefit, we don't just rely on our doctors. Because life and death is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Other things, if it's the sihr of separation, the husband and wife are always arguing. When your spouse is not with you, you miss them. But the second that you see their face, you feel angry for no apparent reason. You argue over little things. There's nothing going on, but you're always arguing. Again, you may see your spouse, you become extremely suspicious of your spouse. This is one of the most common forms of magic, is the sihr of separation. A very important thing is usually when, especially in the Asian and African cultures, we go back to our countries and we're supposed to marry somebody from amongst our family. But for some reason it falls through, we're not interested. Then a very common form of magic is that they will do magic on you so that now you're not able to get married. It's like, "You don't want to marry my son, or you don't want to marry my daughter, okay, you'll never get married to anybody ever." And this is very, very common amongst the youth, especially when somebody comes, they have a good potential partner, everything is good, they are attractive, their deen is good, their character is good, their dunya is good, but something always comes in the way and they never end up getting married. You have sisters and brothers who are 35, 40 years old, have been looking to marry for 15, 16 years, subhanallah, and they can't get married. It's very, very likely that they have sihr done on them. What to recite over this person? When you recite, again, you seek refuge in Allah yourself. Then you start with the basmala, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Then you recite Surah Al-Fatiha, you recite the opening of Surah Al-Baqarah, you recite the 102nd ayah of Surah Al-Baqarah, وَاتَّبَعُوا مَا تَتْلُ الشَّيَاطِينُ عَلَى مُلْكِ سُلَيْمَانَ. And then there are other ayat dotted throughout the Qur'an dealing with magic, dealing with sihr. These ayat are pertaining to Musa alayhi salam and the sorcerers at the time of Musa alayhi salam, the sorcerers of Fir'aun. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions how they bought a magic, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused their magic to come to nothing. And Allah says, وَلَا يُفْلِحُ السَّاحِرُ حَيْثُ أَتَى. And the magician, he will never ever be successful, doesn't matter whatever level he reaches. So we recite the verses of sihr upon this person. And then obviously we have the universal ayat, which I call them, things like Ayatul Kursi, Surah Ikhlas, Surah Falaq, Surah Nas. These are the universal ayat that you will always recite upon any person regardless of whatever condition they are suffering with. When you do this, if the person has sihr in their stomach, then you will find that they might actually vomit. They vomit out and it's very greeny, or it's red, or it's frothing, and they haven't eaten anything. Their food won't come out, something else will be vomited out. Other times they may find, they feel movements over their body, they feel that there's movements in their stomach. It's permissible to recite over water, spit into the water or spittle into the water. Once you've recited, give the person to drink. Give the person this water to drink. Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah, he mentions that this is an innovation, but then other scholars have said no, this is permissible, because we can't blow directly into the mouth of the person, so we blow into the water and we give them the water to drink. And they use the hadith which is in Sahih Muslim, where the Prophet alayhi salam, he allowed anything in ruqya as long as it doesn't contain shirk. As long as it doesn't contain shirk or kufr, then it is permissible in ruqya. Ikhwani, let's talk about now evil eye. Let's talk about ayn. Ayn is a reality. At the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the companions, he was bathing and his skin was very white, and he was fair skinned and he was very muscly. And another companion, he saw him whilst he was bathing. And so this companion, he never said mashaAllah, he never invoked Allah's blessings, he never made dua for this person. And so the companion who was bathing, he fell down and he almost became paralyzed. So they took him to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said to the man, "Who do you accuse? Who do you accuse?" Subhanallah. So he's been wronged. Somebody has done dhulm. Someone has oppressed him. The Prophet alaihi wasallam said, "Who do you accuse?" It's like somebody steals something from you, and you are in front of a judge. You'd say, the judge would ask, "Who do you accuse?" So you've been oppressed. So the Prophet alaihi wasallam, he asked the man, "Who do you accuse?" So the companions, they explained that this was the situation. This was the situation. This other companion, he looked at him, he saw him, but he never said anything, and the man, he fell down. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he ordered the man who had done the evil eye, he ordered him to make wudu. He ordered him to make wudu. They captured the water of the wudu and then they poured it over the man who was suffering. And the narrator, he says, he got up as if there was nothing wrong with him. Something a bit more sort of closer to our time, Sheikh Muqbil, rahimahullah, in Dammaj. Sheikh Muqbil, rahimahullah, in Dammaj. They used to have the dars of hadith. So Sheikh Muqbil, he said to him, "You stand up and you narrate the hadith." And the man, he said, "On the authority of such and such, who heard it from such and such, who heard it from such and such, who heard it from his sheikh, such and such, who heard it from the companion, such and such." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and then he narrated the whole hadith. As soon as he finished, he fainted. The sheikh, may Allah have mercy upon him, he said to the people, he said, "Lock the doors." So they locked the doors and he made everybody do wudu. He made everybody do wudu. They collected the water in a big basin and then they poured it over the man, and he woke up like there was nothing wrong with him. So somebody in that gathering had given him evil eye. And that's why they made the water, they collected the water of wudu. This is what you do if you suspect somebody. So for example, somebody says to you, "You know, your beard is amazing." And he doesn't say mashaAllah, tabarakAllah. You go home that night and your beard is falling out in clumps. You know that this person, it was him. It was him. So subhanAllah, you go to this person and you say, "I need you to make wudu and I need you to give me that water." But subhanAllah, in today's day, it's very rare that somebody will give you their water of wudu because they don't understand. But this is actually mentioned in the hadith. The Prophet alayhi salam, he said that, he told us that if your brother, he asks you for your water of wudu, then you need to give it to him. You need to give it to him. SubhanAllah. So this is one of the ways of, if you know who's done the evil eye, ask them to make wudu, collect their water, and then make ghusl with that water. So just stand in the shower and just pour this water over your head, and the ayn will be lifted with the permission of Allah. What if you can't, find the person? So maybe you were a very gifted workman or a gifted sportsman. All of a sudden, you can't play sports. All of a sudden, your work is going down the drain. You have a bad back every time you go and work. when you're in bed, everything is fine. The second you stand up to go and work, you develop a bad back, or you can't, make anything work in your life at all. In this situation, I found that one of the best ways is to actually take some Zamzam water. Take some Zamzam water, recite on the Zamzam water, make a lot of dua, drink the water at the same time, take the water over your hands and wash your face with the Zamzam water. Other things that you can do, just take normal water if Zamzam isn't available, recite over it, again, the universal ayat. Especially Surah Falaq. Because Allah in this surah we are seeking refuge for the one who does hasad over us. Yeah? The one who does hasad. So we seek refuge in Allah from hasad, from this hatred, this envy, this evil eye. So recite a lot of Surah Falaq and Surah Nas. And recite a lot of that, recite over the water, spittle into the water, drink the water, wash your face with the water. If possible, you can make ghusl with the water. All of this is fine. You need to do it on a day-to-day basis. It needs to be a regular schedule, and inshallah, you'll be fine. How to perform the ruqya? How to perform the ruqya? Again, a massive topic. You could hold a weekend seminar just on how to perform ruqya. But briefly, ruqya is something which you should perform over yourself. If you yourself are suffering, do not let or don't ask somebody else to come and perform ruqya over you. Why? There is a hadith where the Prophet ﷺ, he mentions that 70,000 people from this ummah, they will be entered into Jannah بِغَيْرِ hisab. There is no reckoning for them. There is no punishment for them. They will just be told, يوم القيامة, enter into Jannah. They won't even be held accountable for their deeds. He goes inside into his home. The companions are arguing. Who is it? Maybe it's the one who was born in Islam. Maybe it's the one who never committed shirk. The Prophet alayhi salam, he hears the clamor. He comes outside, says, what are you debating about? They tell him, we're trying to establish who are these 70,000 that will enter into Jannah without any hisab, without any accounting whatsoever. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he mentions that from them, they are those who don't have ruqya made over themselves. This is one of their qualities. They don't ask for ruqya. They don't ask for ruqya. Why? Because they place their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This hadith, we need a bit more explanation. Because if you took this one hadith, you could potentially put yourself into a dangerous situation. Because there are some times where a person isn't physically able to make ruqya over himself. For example, he just says "A'udhu billah," and then his voice, it stops. Or his tongue becomes twisted, or his lips, they seal shut. How do you expect this person to make ruqya over himself? In this situation, it's permissible for his family to call somebody in to make ruqya over him. But again, he shouldn't himself ask for the ruqya. But if one of his family members sees him and they make the ruqya, or they call somebody in to make the ruqya, alhamdulillah, and he allows it, this is fine. He is still within those 70,000, inshallah. Why? Because he never asked for the ruqya. Rather, when somebody came and made it over him, he accepted. But he never went out seeking the ruqya. He put his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you make the ruqya over yourself, sit yourself down, take the ayat that you need to recite, those various ayat, they're widely available on the internet. I have them on a PDF if anybody wants me to email them to them, inshallah. And just sit yourself down, take a glass of water, preferably Zamzam water, and begin the recitation. Put your trust in Allah, begin the recitation. There should be no distractions, no children running around, no music, no TV on in the background, nothing. You sit yourself down, and my intention is, I'm going to make ruqya and I'm going to have an undisturbed ruqya. And then you recite over yourself and you continue to do this. When somebody comes to me and they are afflicted, I always put them on a ruqya plan, a ruqya treatment. It's very rare, like I said, with jinn possession, only jinn possession. Alhamdulillah, it's very easy. They might leave after one session, two sessions, three sessions. With magic, there is a contract. There is a contract between the sahir, between the magician and the jinn itself. And perhaps this was mentioned last time, there is a contract between the magician and the jinn. So they will have a contract. So the magician will do acts of worship, acts of obedience to the jinn, to the shayateen. Some of the acts that they might do, they may make prostration to them, they may sacrifice to them, they may take the Qur'an and stand on it and disgrace the Qur'an, a'udhu billah. They write the Qur'an in urine or in menses blood. They use the Qur'an as toilet paper, a'udhu billah. These people are the lowest of the low. These people are the lowest of the low, and they are disgraced in the dunya and in the akhirah. So they perform these acts. They humiliate themselves. They will live in filth and they will live in dirt. They humiliate themselves. They make themselves small. They make the jinn an act of worship or an object of worship. Then the jinn, they will begin to work for these people. So the sahir and the jinn, they have a contract. Now the jinn will not break this contract. Why? Because he fears that if I break this contract, the sahir will send other jinn after me to kill me. So for example, I've had in the past a jinn say, look, I don't want to leave. And you say, why aren't you going to leave? Because he says, because they have my family and my children, and if I leave, they're going to kill my family and my children. So subhanAllah, this type of thing happens within the jinn world as well. So it's normally a ruqya plan. What do I mention in this plan? The first thing is you need to pray 5 times a day. If you don't pray 5 times a day, you're not going to get better. And that's the beginning and the end of it. If you can't be bothered to pray, then don't think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to send down His shifa upon you. So the first thing is you need to pray 5 times a day. And if you can't be bothered to pray, then, you know, if you can't help yourself and you don't help yourself, then nobody else is going to be helping you. The second thing is that you must make your adhkar. You must make your du'as, your dhikr at the end of Fajr and at the end of Maghrib in particular. We have the book which is called Fortress of a Muslim. There are a lot of du'as in there which you do after Fajr and after Maghrib. You recite them at Fajr time. You are protected by the permission of Allah until Maghrib time. If you recite them at Maghrib time, you're protected until Fajr time. So it's like 24-hour protection as long as you do these adhkar. The third thing, obviously, you recite the ayat of Ruqya. The fourth thing is that you should eat 7 ajwa dates every morning. 7 ajwa dates in the morning. What's the dalil for this? Sahih Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, he who eats 7 ajwa dates every morning will not be affected by poison or magic on the day that he eats them. So eat 7 ajwa dates every single morning, and inshallah, by the permission of Allah, you will be protected. The fifth thing is fasting on Mondays and Thursdays. Fasting on Mondays and Thursdays. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he mentioned that the shaitan, he flows through the sons of Adam like blood. So shaitan flows through our veins like blood. And the scholars, they mentioned that when you are fasting, your blood, your veins become smaller. So there's less room for shaitan to flow through you. And that's why we have less inclination to sin when we are fasting. Because we are fasting, so our veins, and we are hungry, our veins, they constrict. So there's less room for shaitan to come and influence us and flow through our bodies. So when you are suffering, you should fast Mondays and Thursdays. Inshallah, this will make it better. Having hijama, having cupping, this is extremely beneficial. Cupping is extremely beneficial by the permission of Allah. On the authority of Ibn Abbas, and it's recorded in Sahih Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, healing is in 3 things. Drinking honey, the incision, the scratching, the shave, the cutting of the copper, and the cauterization of fire. You know, when you cauterize yourself via fire. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, but I forbid my ummah to use cauterizing. So we can use honey, we can use cupping, and there is also benefit in cauterization, but the Prophet ﷺ has made it haram upon his ummah to have cauterization done. Jabir ibn Abdullah, he reports, which is in a hadith, which is in Bukhari and in Muslim, he heard the Prophet ﷺ say, if there is anything good in the medicines which you treat yourselves with, it is in the incision, the cutting of the copper, or a drink of honey, or cauterization with fire, but I do not like to be cauterized. So cupping is extremely beneficial. There is shifa in cupping with the permission of Allah. The seventh thing that we should do is we should make a lot of dua. We should make a lot of dua. We should remember that Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا هُمْ بِضَارِينَ بِهِ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. They do not harm or they do not bring this harm upon anybody except by the permission of Allah. So when you are suffering, know that it's from the permission of Allah, with the permission of Allah. Know that it's a test from Allah, and know that nobody can help you except with the permission of Allah. So turn to Allah and make a lot of dua. Some people are cured, some people suffer with jinn, magic, evil eye, and simply they make no ruqya whatsoever. Simply through their dua, Allah raises this illness for off them. So subhanAllah, turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The eighth thing, give a lot of charity. Give a lot of charity. It may be that you have committed a sin. Because of that sin, Allah has put this trial upon you. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us that giving in charity, it extinguishes sin the way water extinguishes fire. So give a lot of charity and use that as a wasila, as a means to come close to Allah through your charity. The ninth thing we've mentioned is tawakkul, full trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The tenth thing, if you have any ta'weez, if you have any amulets, anything like this, you need to get rid of them, you need to destroy them. They are not beneficial, they will only cause you harm in the dunya and in the akhirah. There is no benefit from these things. You will destroy yourself in the akhirah. And so destroy them, get rid of them, do whatever you need to do with them. Make tawbah, repent to Allah because you have been indulging in something which is shirk. Make tawbah because you have committed a sin. Make tawbah because you have indulged in something which is an innovation in the religion which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or his companions were not upon. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you for this. Number 11, there should be no pictures on display in your home. There should be no pictures on the walls. There should be no photo frames, be they digital or be they the normal photo frames. If you have pictures of animals, pictures of your kids, pictures of your wife, pictures of your family, pictures of your wedding day, whatever it is, get them down. Get them off your walls, because the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he told us that the angels will not enter into a home where one, there is either a dog, or two, there are pictures on display. So if the angels of Allah are not coming into your home, then know that the shayateen are going to come to your home. Where there are angels, there will not be shayateen. Where there are shayateen, then the angels are not coming to that place. Why? Because it's your fault. It's your fault. Number 12, there should be no music or movies in your home. These are the vices of shaitan. These are the tricks of shaitan. So if you have music, which is the words of shaitan in your home, then the words of shaitan and the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do not mix in the same place. So get rid of the music, get rid of the movies. The point here, ikhwani, all of this, your home needs to be a place of purity. Your home needs to be a place of purity. Because if your home is a place of purity, the shayateen will not enter into that home. When you enter into your home, you say Bismillah. The shayateen won't enter with you. When you eat your food, you say Bismillah. The shaitan can't eat with you. When you go to sleep, you enter into your room, you say Bismillah. You put your clothes on, you say Bismillah. Whatever you do, you say Bismillah. So if he can't enter, there's no place for him to stay. There's no food because you're not allowing him to eat. There's no place to sleep. He's not going to want to enter into your home. It's very, very simple. And inshallah, our shifa has a lot to do with our surroundings. So you'll find that a person, he is suffering. The moment he enters into Makkah, he's absolutely fine. This is to do with what? The barakah of the place. The barakah which Allah has placed in Makkah. He enters into Makkah and he feels light as anything. He leaves Makkah and he's possessed again. Or he feels that his problems are coming back again. The same thing on a mini scale is our homes. If your home is a place of remembrance of Allah, seeking knowledge, place of purity, Quran, Sunnah, etc., then there will be a lot of barakah in this place and the shayateen won't want to enter into this place. If you find that when you are reciting, you have movements in your stomach, then take some senna leaves. Senna is a very, very strong laxative. Take, and it's from the sunnah, as Ibn Qayyim, he mentions. Take some senna leaves, make some tea with the senna leaves. Strong tea, drink that tea. We're trying to wash your stomach out. We're trying to clear your system of any magic that might be in your stomach. If possible, drink a lot of Zamzam water. The Prophet ﷺ, he reported on the authority of Jabir ibn Abdullah that the Prophet ﷺ, he said, the water of Zamzam is for whatever it is drunk for. I.e., whatever reason you drink Zamzam for, then it is for that reason. If you drink it to satisfy your thirst, it's for that reason. If you drink it to be full, it's for that reason. If you drink it as a cure, as a shifa, it's for that reason. And some of the Salaf, they would stand in front of the Kaaba and they would make this, they would say, Oh Allah, it's reported by such and such, on the authority of such and such, on the authority of Jabir ibn Abdullah, that the Prophet ﷺ said, Zamzam is for whatever is drunk for. And then they would say, Oh Allah, bear witness, I'm drinking this Zamzam, so I am not thirsty on Yawm al-Qiyamah. This is the dua that they would make. So subhanAllah, Zamzam is for whatever it is drunk for. Make a lot of dua, and Zamzam is shifa. And finally, if there is any sin which you are indulging in, and this sin is between you and Allah, sins prevent shifa from coming down. If there are any sins that you are indulging in, then leave these sins to the best of your ability. We're always going to sin, we're created weak, and every one of us sins. But leave those sins which you know you are doing. Leave those sins which you do on purpose. Do your best to leave those, because that might be a block as to why shifa is not coming down. Many times people come to me and they say, I've been doing ruqya for like 2 years and I recite Surah Al-Baqarah every day and I do the hijama and I do this and I do that. And then I say, okay, tell me, where is Allah? And they say, Allah is everywhere. And I say, okay, that's the reason why the shifa is not coming down. You don't know your aqeedah. You don't know your aqeedah. So the point here is this. We need to know our aqeedah, we need to know tawheed, we need to know sunnah, we need to stay away from shirk and bid'ah, and then the shifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come down. Okay. I want to mention now some incorrect forms of ruqya. So you'll go to Peer Sahib, you'll go to Sheikh Sahib, Maulana Sahib, whatever it might be, and he'll ask you, give me an item of your clothing, give me a bangle, give me a piece of your hair, give me your earring, something like this. This is an incorrect form of ruqya. Why? Because what they do is they have jinn which work for them, and when you give them your item of clothing, then it gives them a trail. It gives them a part of your DNA, and then they know that this is the person who you need to go and inflict, or this is the person who you need to go and protect. So for example, Abdullah ibn Masud, he comes home one day and his wife is wearing a string around her neck. He asks his wife, why are you wearing it? She says that my eye was twitching. My eye was twitching, i.e. she was getting some discomfort. And I put this on and now my eye has stopped twitching. Abdullah ibn Masud radiallahu anhu, he becomes extremely angry. He breaks that string from his wife's neck and he says, verily, this was a jinn which was touching your eye. And the second that you put this on, it left you. And then he says, the house of Abdullah has no need for shirk. The house of Abdullah has no need for shirk. So the point here is this, your kids at night time, they're being given trouble by the jinn. You may find that things are going missing. The jinn are just being mischievous and causing you issues. You've got two options now. Do you deal with it the proper way? Recitation of Quran, get rid of photos, etc., etc. Or do you go to Mawlana Sahib, pay him some money, and what he does is, he'll say, okay, give me something. Give me your mom's name. Give me your date of birth. Give me your father's name. And then what they will do from this, their jinn know now that this is the person. This is the person. And then they will go, and his jinn who are working with him, they will go and they will either fight against those jinn who are giving you trouble, or they will make a pact with them saying, look, you need to leave them alone. You think, alhamdulillah, I've benefited, but what you don't know is you've committed shirk in the process. I want to give you an example to try and make you understand this. And I always mention this because it's probably the closest example that we can get. When you have these police chase programs, and the criminal, it's nighttime, it's pitch black, the criminal, he goes and he hides in the forest. He goes and hides in the forest, the police dogs come with the sniffer dogs. And the police will give him, like, they'll make the dog sniff a shirt, or they'll make him sniff something. And so the dog now has a trail, it knows who I'm going to look for. And it goes in the pitch black and it finds that person and it brings him out. Why? Because it has a trail. It knows who it's looking for. The same way, when you go and you give Mawlana Sahib your name, your date of birth, etc., the jinn have a trail. They know the identifying factor. This is the individual who we are going to try and find. This is the individual who we are looking for. And then this is how it works. Another thing, many a time they will tell you to call on Abdul Qadir al-Jilani, who was a humbly scholar, and he's free of all the shirk that they commit with him. He was a humbly scholar, and they'll say, "Yeah, say, yeah, Abdul Qadir al-Jilani, you'll feel fine." And the point here is this: when a person commits shirk, then shaitan, he has attained the goal, which is to mislead all of mankind or most of mankind and take him to the hellfire. You've committed shirk, they've done their job now, and now they'll stop hassling you. The second you come back to tawheed, the second you come back to sunnah, your problems will begin again. The same thing with ta'weez, you put it around your neck, etc. I've opened hundreds of ta'weez, never ever opened one which was just Quran. There was one which was just Quran, and I smelt it, and it was the paper had been urinated on before the Quran had been written on it. Other times you'll find Quran, you'll find Ayatul Kursi, but in the corner, Ya Jibreel, Ya Israfil, Ya Mika'il, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, calling upon the creation. This is shirk and it's not permissible. Other times they say Ya Abdul Qadir al-Jilani. You'll also find loads of different names of the shayateen, Badu, and all these different names. They're calling upon them. And this is a pact. You'll find stars of David, you will find random letters, random numbers, random lines. This is all a way of the magician forming his contract with the shayateen. Ikhwani, in ending, I'm going to end a little bit sooner because just in case you brothers have any questions. We find, subhanAllah, as individuals and as Muslims, if ever there is an issue, we go running to the doctor. We go running to the doctor and we seek this medicine. There's nothing wrong with that. But subhanAllah, why don't we turn to the Qur'an? Why don't we turn to Allah? Why don't we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who sent down this test as a trial, as a fitna for us? My aim is to make everybody use the Qur'an the way we use paracetamol. Why? Because whenever we have a headache, we have a cold, we feel tired, we feel sick, the first thing that we do is we take two paracetamols. This is the first thing that we do. And then if it gets worse, then we'll go to the doctor again. We'll go for this checkup, that checkup, this checkup, that checkup. And then we'll go to all the specialists in the world. And then when they tell us we don't know what it is, then we think, what's left? Okay, I'll make dua. Okay, I'll use Quran. Why didn't we use this first? Why didn't we do this first? When we took the paracetamols, before we took the paracetamols, why didn't we make ruqya on ourselves and then we take the paracetamols? Why didn't we recite over water, drink the water, recite over olive oil, you know, use the olive oil, massage the olive oil into the place of your pain? Why didn't you use the words of Allah, which is a shifa from beginning to end? And why have we abandoned this way and then we only come back to it when we have no other option? We have no other option. Ikhwani, this is not how we should be as Muslims. The companions, whenever they would be in any issue, they would make ruqya over themselves. Imagine this. A scorpion, it stings you. A poisonous scorpion stings you. The first thing that me and you would do is we would run to the hospital for anti-venom. But the companions, they would recite Surah Al-Fatiha 3 times. And they would spit in the area where the sting had been. And the person is cured by the permission of Allah. Subhanallah. So look, this Quran, it has a physical benefit. It's not just a spiritual benefit. It has a physical benefit which we need to take and we need to make use of. And like I said, use the Quran the way you use paracetamol. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us a clear understanding of ruqya. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from magic and jinn and evil eye. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us firm on tawheed, firm against shirk, firm upon sunnah, firm against innovation. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to raise in every single family at least one person who understands ruqya, so that if there ever is an issue, the people can make ruqya upon their own families. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Jazakallah khair for that informative talk. We'd like to open up to the floor for questions. Are there any questions?
Sorry, I thought the brother's a question about the...
We'll leave that till the end, okay, inshallah. Okay, I've got a number of questions that have come through from the sisters. The first one is, What about pictures and how about, you talked about pictures, sorry. What about toys and teddy bears?
Okay, as for toys and teddy bears, then as long as the teddy bears don't have faces on them, if they do have faces on them, then I think the safest option is not to buy them. But if you need to buy them, make sure when you finish with them, you don't leave them out. So maybe have like a cupboard or a drawer or something like that. You put the keep the toys in there. When the kids play with them, when they finish play with them, make sure you put them away so that these faces are not on open display, and Allah knows best.
Okay. Regarding, you talked about music and movies. How about computer games?
Okay, computer games, we're getting a bit sort of sidetracked because if we find most of the computer games, they encourage disobedience to Allah, Grand Theft Auto, steal cars, murder people, etc. You know, general music involved. There's a lot of women in the video games now as well. But if you're playing something like FIFA, it's harmless. There's no problem there, alhamdulillah. But if you're playing something which is encouraging disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're wasting a lot of time in that. Then obviously the more time that you dedicate to this, the less time you're dedicating to Quran, the less time you're dedicating to seeking knowledge. So in moderation, inshallah, it's okay as long as it doesn't take over your life and it's not like the subject of your life, because like I said, it will take you away from salah, it will take you away from Quran, it will take you away from remembrance of Allah, and if you do that, then you're going to leave yourself wide open anyway.
What exactly is copying and what does it entail?
Okay, hijama, basically what they do, there's two types of cupping. You have fire cupping and then you have the cupping which they use like a pump. And the more common method is the cupping where they use a pump. So what they'll do first, and the sunnah points are on the back of your neck and across the top of your shoulders. And it's a good question because it reminds me. If you are suffering with magic or jinn possession, get the top of your head cupped. Get the top of your head cupped. It's a very, very beneficial thing with the permission of Allah. So what you do, you have the tops of your shoulders, what they'll do, obviously if it's a sister, then it needs to be a sister. For a brother, it needs to be a brother. What they'll do, they have a pump and they put like a glass upon your back. And this pump, as they pull it, it sucks the skin into this pump. And what it does is it causes the blood to come out into this area. Then what they'll do, they'll leave this suction, like they'll leave this like, you know, as it is sucked in for about 5 or 10 minutes. And this brings all the blood to the surface. What they'll then do is they'll take a clean blade and they'll make tiny incisions into your back. And then what they'll do after this, they'll put the same pump back on and they'll put that same suction in, and then blood will begin to come out. It's very, very beneficial. You know, it's enough to say that the Prophet ﷺ said that there is benefit in it, but also if there's any clots in your blood, if there's any, you know, the blood tends to clot and get thick, any thick clotted blood, then this will be a point of benefit by the permission of Allah. And the same thing on the top of the head. For the brothers, you need to shave your head and you need to attach the cups to the head. And also for the sisters, you do need to shave a small area into your hair for the cup to be able to attach to the top of your head. But inshallah, the hair will regrow, and if you have long hair, then you can cover it up as well.
Final question here from the sisters. What do you do if your iman is weakening? That is, you make a lot of dua for something, but still it's not happening for you. What can you do?
Again, this is a separate issue. Why isn't dua accepted? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves for us to make dua. And the Prophet alayhi salam, he told us, do not become impatient in making dua. If we look at like Ibraheem alayhi salam and the fitna that he had, he wasn't able to have children. Some of the scholars mentioned he made dua for 80 years that Allah blesses him with a son. We have Zakaria alayhi salam, he was old and his hair was grey. He still never had a son, but he made dua. Allah blessed him with a son. We have Ayyub alayhi salam. We have Yusuf alayhi salam. All of the prophets, we look at how much dua they made. We make dua for 1 year and it's not answered, and we begin to get impatient. We begin to become impatient. So continue with your dua. Don't give up, because Allah loves it when you make dua. Dua is one of the highest forms of ibadah. As the Prophet alayhi salam, he said, "Ad-du'a huwa al-ibadah." Dua is the essence and is worship. So continue to make a lot of dua. Don't become impatient. There may be a sin which you are indulging in, which is making your dua not answered. You may be indulged in interest. Your parents may be upset with you. There may be any issue like this. You may not know your aqeedah. make sure all of the doors are closed for the dua not to be accepted, and then inshallah have patience and continue to make dua and know that this is an act of worship. You'll be rewarded just for making dua. As the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he told us that Allah is shy when we raise our hands. Allah is shy to allow our hands to come back down, and yet He hasn't blessed us with anything. So subhanAllah, Allah becomes subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one of the attributes of Allah, that Allah becomes shy to let His slave lower his hands and He hasn't blessed him with something. So Allah loves it when we make dua. Continue to make dua, and inshaAllah, if it's good for you in the dunya and in the akhirah, then it will happen. But it may be that the thing that you are asking for is not good for your akhirah nor for your dunya. You think it's good for you, but it's not. And Allah knows better, therefore He's protecting you from this. So continue to make dua and ask Allah that if it's good for your deen or dunya, then He will give it to you. And if there's something better, then He will replace it with that. And Allah knows best.
Okay. Any questions? Okay, Sayyid?
Can non-Muslims inflict you with evil eye? Yes, absolutely. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that as for the disbelievers, they seek to cause you harm through their gaze. And Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he mentions about this ayah. I can't remember which ayah exactly it is, but he mentions about this ayah. This is dalil, that the vision of the non-Muslims, they with their hatred and their evil, they can give you evil eye from the non-Muslims as well. I'm sorry. The brother asks, there's a hadith in which the Prophet alayhi salam, he mentions that the shayateen, they spread out and they spread through the earth at Maghrib time. And bring your children in at this time, close your windows, mention the name of Allah, say Bismillah, etc. And the brother asks, does this include internal doors as well? No, this is only for the external doors. The Prophet alayhi salam, he told us to close our windows and our doors, mention the name of Allah, say Bismillah while we do it, because then the shaytan can't enter in through that closed door. But this is only for external doors, and it doesn't apply to internal doors, because the shayateen, the khubath and the khaba'ith, they live inside these places of filth anyway. They live with us in our homes and in our residences, and I don't want to freak anybody out, but you know, they live with us, and most of them are fine, most of them are harmless. But it's only when they become mischievous and they begin to give us issues, this is when we should bring our children in. And obviously, anyway, we should say Bismillah, etc. This is a habit that we should do as Muslims anyway.
Brother Atif,
does evil eye happen straight away? If somebody put on somebody else, would the effect happen straight away?
Absolutely. The brother asked, is evil eye, the effects of evil eye, are they immediate? The answer is yes. That companion who was showering, he was absolutely fine. The companion looked at him, he immediately dropped down. Immediately dropped down. The same thing with what I mentioned from Sheikh Muqbil. It's not a dalil in our religion, but it's just backing this point up, is that obviously as soon as the brother, he narrated the whole chain, he narrated the sanad, and he narrated the matan of the hadith, as soon as he did that, he dropped down and he fainted. So it's immediate, and it hits, it's like an arrow, it hits straight away.
Brother Abdurrahman,
is it permissible to use evil eye as a Muslim against non-believers who are harming Muslims, for example? Like making the dua against the kuffar, for example.
Is it permissible to use evil eye against the non-Muslims who are harming the Muslims? And the brother said, make dua. For example, making dua against them. Making dua and evil eye is something different. Invoking the curse of Allah upon the enemies of Allah, this is permissible. The Prophet alayhi salam, he did this. As for evil eye, like it says, as it's in English, evil eye is evil from beginning to end. Evil eye will only result when there is like an evil in your heart, and as a result of that evil, that person is afflicted. So evil eye from beginning to end is haram, and we should try and stay away from it. How do we stay away from evil eye? I'll mention this point because it's important. How do we stay away from evil eye? Number one, do not become extravagant. If Allah has blessed you with something, don't show off. Because naturally, when people see you with this thing, then they will become jealous. There will be parts of them who will become jealous, and they may give you the evil eye. The second thing, seek refuge in Allah from the evil eye. أَعُوذُ بِكَلِمَاتِ اللَّهِ التَّامَّ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْطَانٍ وَهَمَّ وَمِنْ كُلِّ عَيْنٍ لَامَّ Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would make this dua. And part of that, he would seek refuge in the perfect words of Allah from the evil eye. from the evil eye. So we can seek refuge in Allah from the evil eye. Another thing is how to prevent yourself from giving evil eye. If you see a blessing, somebody who has been blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his wealth, in his body, in his knowledge, etc., say, MashaAllah, Tabarakallah, this closes the door. This closes the door. So you feel some sort of evil building up inside of your heart. MashaAllah, Tabarakallah. You invoke the blessings of Allah. You make dua for that person. When you make dua, then this will close the doors to this evil eye and it will protect from that. So evil eye in and of itself is evil. It's haram like magic. There is some knowledge which is okay. Some knowledge which is good. Some knowledge which in and of itself is haram. Knowledge of magic is in and of itself haram. And the same thing with evil eye, in and of itself, it's haram. So yes, if there is somebody has wronged you, etc., and you want to make dua against that person, this is permissible. But to try and give them evil eye, this is haram because it's as a result of a diseased heart. So we should stay away from that, inshallah.
Okay. Any more questions? Okay, inshallah, we will conclude this evening and this talk. I want to sincerely thank... Oh, just one thing. I've just been reminded. We've got to ask the question for our prize tonight. And Brother Husnayn.
Okay, the question that I want to ask is, when a person is possessed, hijama is very, very beneficial. When a person is possessed, hijama is extremely beneficial, more so than normal. Why is that? Interested, brother?
Yeah, brother, say.
The shaitan runs in the blood. So when you take the blood
out. Yes, this is, the brother has it spot on, mashallah. I mentioned the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us that shaitan, he flows through our veins like blood. When the person is possessed, the jinn is flowing through his veins. When you do the cupping and you take the blood out, sometimes by the grace of Allah, without any ruqya, the jinn comes out in the blood. The jinn comes out in the blood. You don't even do ruqya on the person, but the jinn comes out in the blood, which is as a result of the cupping. So that's why cupping is extremely beneficial. And if it doesn't take the jinn out completely, it will weaken the jinn by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to benefit from that which we have heard, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from all of these evil things.
Okay, Jazakallah khair. Can I ask you one final question? One other question has just come through. And the question is, can you give the evil eye without it being on purpose, intended?
Yes, you can. The question was, can the evil eye come without intention? The answer is yes, the evil eye can come without intention. The companion, he never had the intention of this evil eye, but because he never invoked the blessings of Allah, he never said MashaAllah, Tabarakallah, etc., then the evil eye resulted. So evil eye can come without intention, which is why it's extremely important. If we see something pleasing, we see something beautiful, we must say MashaAllah. We must invoke the blessings of Allah. If you have children and they are beautiful and very cute and they are lovely and you see them playing, etc., they fall prey to evil eye very quickly. Again, say MashaAllah, close the door, and after that, inshallah, you don't have anything to worry about.
Jazakallah khair, Brother Husnayn. Alhamdulillah and MashaAllah, it's great to see so many brothers attending today. We've got another 4 weeks of lectures. Next week, inshallah, Brother Akil Mahmood from Green Lane Masjid will be attending, and his talk will be on protecting yourself from evil. I would also request that you make dua for Brother Husnayn, who inshallah tomorrow will be setting out on his journey for Umrah, and inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect him and make his journey easy. And inshallah, we also request that you remember us in your duas. Okay, Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.